Let's turn our Bibles to Luke chapter 19. I'm going to do 28 to 37. The triumphal entry. When he had said this, he went on ahead, going to Jerusalem. And it came to pass, when he drew near Bethpage and Bethany at the mountain called Olivet, that he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village opposite you, where as you enter you'll find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, 'Why are you loosing it?' thus you shall say to him, 'Because the Lord has need of it.'" So those who were sent went their way and found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, "Why are you loosing the colt?" And they said, "The Lord has need of him." And they brought him to Jesus, and they threw their own clothes on the colt, and they set Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes and were on the road. I'm going to stop right there. Millions of people today are gathered in church, right? To celebrate Palm Sunday. We may have heard this message and this Bible story thousands of times. I'm going to be 51 years old, and we know what today represents. Amen?
Amen.
Christians all over the world come to celebrate this wonderful event. It is the essence of who we are. It is the essence of whose we are.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Without Jesus' life, without Jesus' death, and without Jesus' resurrection, there is no Christianity.
How would you?
I'm going to say it again.
Praise God.
Without Jesus' life, without Jesus' death, without our Jesus' resurrection, there would be no Christianity today. There would be no hope today. There will be nothing for us today. Even the Jewish nation considered this week sacred and holy.
Yes.
Did you know that?
Yes.
Passover, which commemorates the exodus of the Jews. The exile. The exodus of Egypt, when God delivered the Jews from their oppressors. This was a big deal. God delivered the Jews with his mighty hand.
Yes.
He used a servant, Moses.
Yes.
Can you say that again? He used a servant. He used a servant, Moses, and the 10 plagues. The last one becoming the most critical one, when God sent an angel of death to kill every firstborn of every living thing in Egypt. The story is recorded in Exodus chapter 12. The Passover and the festival of the unleavened bread. Just imagine the weeping. Imagine the pain. Imagine the wails of the people crying because they lost something. The only way the Jewish nation would be saved was if they marked their door with the blood. With the blood. If they marked that door with the blood of the Lamb, they had to find blood.
Yes.
And that was the way the angel of death would skip, when they recognized that blood. And that's where they get Passover. Hallelujah. There is just something about the blood of Jesus. There is just something about the blood that was shed.
Thank you, Lord.
There's just something precious about the blood. You see, that precious blood cleansed me of my sins. I don't stand before my brethren acting like I've arrived. That blood gave me a new identity. That blood gave me new hope. That blood gave me life. That blood was not shed in vain. That blood did what it had to do. There is something about the blood of Jesus. That precious blood that washed my sins white as snow and restored me. gave me a good, clean identity. And through that blood that was shed, every covenant and promise has been put into effect.
Hallelujah.
Hebrews 9:22 says, and according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood. And without the shedding of the blood, there is no remission. That blood had to be shed for me. That blood had to be shed for us. As we read of the triumphant entrance, the city's population almost tripled during this festivity. Imagine, tripled. We had a parade this Thursday in New York City. 2 million people were expected to be in this parade. Imagine the work that our police department had to do. Both the ones decoyed and the ones in uniform. Imagine the work. Well, here, the Bible records that this was a major event.
Yes.
And everyone and anyone was coming into Jerusalem for the Passover feast.
Yes.
They heard of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
They knew of him. Mm-hmm. And many even were following him.
Yes.
There were many bystanders that even witnessed his miraculous signs,
yes.
his miracles.
Yes.
Everybody was talking about him. The crowds loved him on this day. Many even heard his sermons. I am the bread of life.
Yes.
Thank you, Brother Rand.
You're welcome.
Because man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. I am, Jesus says, the bread of life.
Hallelujah.
I am the light of the world. I am the gate, the gate for the sheep and the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the light. I am the resurrection. I am the true vine. I am King. Jesus was famous. I could imagine if he was coming to New York City today, what the New York Post and the New York Times would have. The Son of Man who turned water into wine, who heals the leper, who calms the sea, who heals the lame, the Son of Man who gives sight to the blind, this Jesus who heals the woman with the issue of blood, this man who feeds 5,000, man feeds 4,000, this man who heals the demon possessed, this Jesus who raised Lazarus from the grave. So here's our Jesus making his entrance into Jerusalem. Jesus sent two disciples. He was very specific. You're gonna go to this close by village. You're gonna find a colt. You're gonna get the colt for my grand entrance. This is important. God never leaves room for mistake.
So true.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
God does not leave room for mistakes.
Hallelujah.
What doesn't make sense for us, it's God's perfect will.
Hallelujah.
Our God doesn't make mistakes.
Amen.
He leaves no room for error.
Right.
Our God is a God of order.
Thank you, Lord.
He tells his disciples exactly where they're going to go, exactly where the cult will be, exactly what to say.
Yes.
If they're asked. The Lord needs it. The owners seemed quite willing to release their colt. The disciples made their own cushions and saddles for Jesus as Jesus begins his journey. Here is Jesus entering. As they praised all the mighty acts they had seen, they hailed him, King of kings and Lord of lords, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. the highest. Imagine that.
Glory.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, Lord Jesus Christ.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Hosanna! Hosanna! Hosanna in the highest.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Shh, here he is! Hosanna! 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 Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Their shout of praise was really a shout of save us! Save us! Save us! How many times have we had to shout? Save us! Save us! Mark 10:45 says, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom. You know what? The Jewish people, they knew their word.
Yes.
You talk to a Jewish person, you better know what you're talking about.
Yes.
Because they know their word.
Yes.
They got excited because they knew there was prophecy being fulfilled. They knew the word.
Yes.
In Zechariah 9:9. They knew. They got excited. Jesus was fulfilling the prophecy given in Zechariah, where it says, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a what? On a donkey, on a colt, a foal of a donkey. They knew their word. Why a colt, should we ask? Such a strange thing. What a strange request for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords to request a colt. Something that had never been ridden before, unridden. You ever tried to get on a horse that doesn't have a lot of experience having people? A horse not being ridden is a big deal. It takes time to train a horse. I had a friend that took me horseback riding. It was a lot of fun. I was scared. I had a big horse. They gave me a big horse to hold this big girl. And I felt so high on this horse, and it was pretty intimidating. And the lady was telling me exactly what to do. And I went online just to say, Lord, what is really the significance of this colt? To train a horse, you have to create an environment where they can learn. And you know what I thought was pretty cool? It has to be a quiet place.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hello? Hosanna! 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 Imagine, had to be a quiet place. God is showing without even saying a word. There's a sermon right there.
Yes.
In the midst of the noise, in the midst of the trials, in the midst of the problems and issues.
Yes.
God is in control.
Yes.
That alone, I said, wow, Lord. He showed his power and dominion over an untamed animal.
Yes.
A quiet place where there's no distraction. They have to help if the horse is distracted and has things going on, can't learn. So they start off by putting him by himself in his little thing. No distractions. Then they may get another horse, and now the other horse is the only distraction. Imagine, we're not hearing noise and parades and screaming. And the weather also plays a factor, whether there's lightning, whether it's snowing, whether it's raining, right? According to the Old Testament guidelines, for an animal to be used for a sacred purpose, it must have never been used for anything else.
Yes.
Not for any purpose at all. Our God is a God of order. He's not going to contradict what the word says.
So true.
This colt was certainly selected for a sacred purpose. Jesus riding on this colt showed that he was in control of this event. The colt that no one had ever ridden was suitable for our king. The Lord needs it was all they had to say, the two disciples. The Lord needs it.
Hallelujah.
God's timing is perfect.
Hallelujah.
He chose, right, Passover day, this festivity, knowing that they would come from everywhere and they would be here. His timing is perfect. Sometimes we pray and go boo-hoo in our little, in our pity party. God's timing is perfect.
Amen.
God knows when to say yes, when to say no, and if you're gonna ever see it or not. Mm-hmm. His timing is perfect.
Amen.
Jesus' timing was perfect to announce that he was indeed the Messiah that they had been waiting for. He chose a time when all of Israel would be gathered. His mission was being fulfilled. They were sure that their liberator was at hand. They received him with gladness, and the people tore palm trees. Palm Sunday. Okay? The people that did not have a lot of money would go to the olive trees and pull out the palms, and they would use the palms.
Yes.
Those that had more to do, offer, they gave him homage by putting their clothes, their cloths, so that Jesus would walk through it. He was forcing people to make a decision that day. Did you know that?
Yes.
We, people of God, have a decision to make.
Yes.
The Pharisees were upset. They were so upset. How dare they publicly honor Jesus? This is sacrilegious. Blasphemy. You see, they too had hidden motives.
Yes.
They were threatened by Jesus' knowledge and following. They were paranoid of losing their status, their authority. The religious establishment really hated Jesus because they were jealous of him. They asked Jesus, rebuke your disciples. Make them be quiet. Now, before I talk about the rebuke portion of it, can I just get a little real here?
Yes, please.
Because I felt this in my spirit, and it's just a thought. Did you know that sometimes people are jealous of you?
Yes.
People, perhaps sometimes, are threatened by your anointing?
Yes.
Shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. People shouldn't, Christians should not be jealous of one another. But sometimes we have problems when we see God blessing and honoring people. Sometimes the body of Christ has problems when God publicly honors a brethren. They fail to see the time that they spent seeking God's presence. They fail to see God's direction. They are clueless of the battles and the oppositions that we encounter. How sad is that when our brothers and sisters are blessed by God, and we don't want to rejoice? You know what? When our brothers are blessed, we should be dancing and rejoicing.
Yes, that's right. Amen.
And you know what? When one of our brothers and sisters falls flat on their face, we should be crying.
Yes,
that's right.
So true.
It should hurt us.
Yes. Yes.
It should not make us happy.
Not at all.
It should not make us laugh.
That's true.
It should not open up the door to gossip.
Amen.
When my sister or my brother falls, I throw myself deeper into the floor. Because today, them, tomorrow, me. It's that bad. I know that I've heard a lot of say that the Christian army is the only army that injures their own soldiers. So, when we see our brothers or our sisters struggling, we should lift them up in prayer.
Yes.
When we don't see someone here for 2 or 3 weeks, we should call them.
Yes.
Find out if they're okay.
Go ahead.
If they're in Cancun on the beach, that's all good.
Yeah.
If they're sitting relaxing in Cancun with a piña colada, it's all good. I was on vacation. But if you don't see your brother and sister, and then the next Sunday comes, and the next Sunday comes, it should bother us.
Yes.
It should stir up something in our spirit. Mm-hmm. We should be looking out for each other.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
The word of God in Hebrews 10:24 says, and let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to do good work.
Amen.
1 Peter 4:8, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over multitude of sins.
Yes.
I am not standing before you because I've arrived. I'm dirt, filthy rag as well. Mm-hmm. And you know what? I'd rather have a sister or a brother say, Daisy, you're doing it wrong. Daisy, I'm praying for you. Daisy, trust me, I did that. It doesn't work. I'd rather have correction with love from a brother or sister than praise from a fool. That's gonna guide me right to hell.
Right,
Jesus. Psalms 133:1 says, how good and pleasant it is when brothers live together in unity. So I had to share that portion because the Lord put that in my spirit. The Pharisees were very jealous. Mm-hmm. They were threatened.
Yes.
The Son of Man needed a cult. Imagine that. The reality is, God is able to use anyone or anything He wants.
Amen.
But not everyone responds to the call. I'm not comparing anyone here to a cult. I'm not comparing us to donkey. But the truth is, there's a lot of work to be done in the kingdom.
Yes.
And the fact that we're talking about this cult today, it was his time, this little donkey. Mm-hmm. It was his time to make history. And that was the animal chosen. And I always say to the Lord, if you can use a donkey, Lord, if you can use a donkey. The Pharisees were threatened. Keep them quiet. Tell them to be quiet. And Jesus' response was an eye-opener. If they remain quiet, the stones will cry out. I've had to do this sometimes, you know, because sometimes people go through rough times. And they come and they have nothing left inside of them. I don't know if you've been there. Mm-hmm. Allow me to do this. How many times, Lord, has a rock had to cry out in my place?
Yes.
Because God is still seated on his
yes.
throne.
Yes.
God is still seated on his throne.
Amen.
It's not about me.
No,
it's not about if everything went well this week and my children were all right and they all got A's. It's not about the bills are paid and the covers are filled up. How many times has a rock had to cry out in my place? And you know what? The bigger the issue. How many times has a rock had to cry out in our place? Jesus entered into Jerusalem and he was weeping.
Yes.
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 Crying, the Son of God, the Son of Man.
Jesus.
He's entering, making a statement, yet he's weeping. He's crying over Jerusalem. He was looking beyond the praises.
Yes.
You could be as broken as they come. He looked beyond the Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace, peace. Jesus wept right through the praise and cheers, beyond the smiles and the shouts. He looked deep within the heart and the condition of the land.
My God.
He sees the condition of the heart.
Yes.
Yes, he does. Thank you.
Jesus saw phoniness. He saw the phoniness in their hearts. He knew 5 days later they would turn on him.
Yes.
Hosanna! 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 5 days He wept over the people. He knew he would give his life for a ransom for the world. Jesus sees our heart.
Yes.
We can fool one another.
True.
We really could. We know the talk. We know how to dress the part. We can fool each other. And sadly to say, many of us even fool ourselves.
True.
You ever met a pathological liar? He starts to believe his own lies. That's fooling yourself. You're deep into what reality really isn't. Jesus looked at the tears. But I'll tell you this much, God will not be mocked.
True.
God sees it all. How many tears has God cried on my behalf?
Yes.
I'm asking myself that. When God looked into Daisy's heart,
yes.
How many times did he shed a tear for me? When God looks at our heart, what is he looking at? Is your heart his home that he has taken residence? Think about that. You ever been to a home where you just did not feel welcome?
Sure.
You almost feel like, huh, I don't know how to leave. I just been here for 10 minutes. This is so awkward. Have you ever been to a home where you weren't welcome? It's not a good feeling. Imagine Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. But deep into the heart, he's crying. Mm-hmm. They don't know me. They don't really love me. They got it all wrong. And you know what came into my heart? Can you give me my bag? My little baggie. Thank you, Lester. I love Brother Lester. Thank you, Brother Lester. You know what the fact of the matter is? Sometimes we come into the house of God. I'm going to talk loud because I can't do that again.
Amen.
Sometimes we come into the house of God more broken than a puzzle. Yeah. Think about it. Our children are rebellious.
Yes.
Nothing's going right. We're broken, but we smile. Some of us are dealing with depression, and we, God bless you, and we're broken inside. We're broken inside because people have scorned us. People have done cruel things to our lives, and we come into church broken. We come into church seeking refuge. We come into church desperate. I've heard people in their 40s and 50s that things happened to them when they were 5. And they're still broken.
My Jesus.
God was weeping because he knew he was the answer. Yes. Jesus, the Son of God. He didn't walk around saying, I am King of Kings. I am God. You're going to worship me. He was so careful with his identity.
Yes.
He wasn't flaunting himself like the peacock.
No.
He saw the brokenness.
Yes.
We're breaking each other sometimes.
So true.
We're hurting each other sometimes. You know what? We have to keep it real before the presence of God.
Yes.
When you come to church, you're not coming to church because you're perfect and you arrive. You come because you're broken.
Right.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
We come with burdens,
yes.
Heavy burdens.
Yes.
Our homes, perhaps in chaos, rebellious children, teenagers. Our minds are running a mile a minute. We can't even concentrate on the sermon.
Yes.
Have you ever been there before?
Yes.
I've been there.
Yes.
I've been there when I came in and I was like in a cloud maze. No one ever said being a Christian was going to be the tulips, smelling the roses. You know, being a Christian means sometimes you'll have to walk with a broken leg to get to church. Being a Christian sometimes means you have to be made fun of.
Yes.
Being a Christian sometimes means you have to give up some people in your life. Being a Christian sometimes means you're going to have to sleep less and pray more. God never said we weren't going to have trials and tribulations. Read the whole book of James. Count it all joy. Count it all joy. It's not easy being a Christian. You think it was easy for Jesus to do what he had to do?
No.
Knowing as they were worshiping him and praising him, they were really shouting, save us.
Yes.
Yet they would deny him.
Yes.
If you think about it, we need just to press forward. The Bible says in Philippians 3:14, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, let us, as many as are mature, have this mind. And if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even this to you. Nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us be of the same mind. We need to be disciplined.
Yes.
We need to be focused.
Yes.
We need to be determined.
Yes.
We need to pursue Jesus.
Lord.
Pursuing the call of a true Christian.
Yes.
You know, when the people came up here to pray, no one knew. Everyone, you may have known that I was going to preach about Palm Sunday, but no one really knew the message. No one really knew I was going to talk about brotherly love.
Mm-hmm.
No one knew I was going to talk about being broken, Joshua, that prayed, people that are broken. I was like, how compassionate is it that a young man would think, Lord, forgive us. Help those that are feeling hurt. Help those that are struggling. Well, I told them they better just stop drinking. Because I am so much more disciplined. No, that's wrong. Unless you've struggled with alcohol, you don't know the depth. Unless you've struggled with something, don't come here and tell me you've arrived.
Mm-hmm.
Pray and help them.
Amen.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
We want to see change.
Yes.
Sister Sharon said, change is coming.
Amen.
Pastor Albert stood here, I don't know if it was 2 weeks ago,
mm-hmm.
There's a change coming.
Yes.
But you know what? We need to change.
Yes.
That change that's coming, our four walls, right? God is taking us from glory to glory.
Yes.
There's got to be a change here too.
Yes.
There has to be a change.
Mm-hmm.
Think about it. If I'm repeating the same sin over and over and over again,
mm-hmm.
Have I really changed for the better? If I'm struggling 3 years ago, going on 4 years, struggling with the same thing. Have I really made a true decision to follow my King of Kings and Lord of Lords? There has to be change. If God took me out of the pit of hell, he changed me. He gave me a new identity. There has to be change. We can't continue to live and complete. Forgive me, Lord Jesus. Maybe I'll sin again next week, but I'll pray and say, forgive me, Lord Jesus, with the same thing. And I myself played that game.
Mm-hmm.
I myself am guilty as charged.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's just my thing, you know. God will, he understands. It's my weakness. He understands. And one day the light bulb went, bing, the Holy Spirit. More like a smack. But it happened. Daisy, are you really sorry? Are you really, when you go before the Lord and say, forgive me, do you really mean it? Because why do you keep doing it? Why can't this flesh submit to the living God? Why can't my needs and my flesh and my desires submit to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Am I that selfish? And the light bulb went off and I said, you know what, Lord? You're right. You're right, Lord. I say I'm sorry, but then I go right back and do it. You know, there has to be a change in us. God did not shed his blood in vain.
Hallelujah.
He did not. Do you think God cares about our circumstances? Do you think God cares when we walk in with issues and problems? He absolutely does. He cares about every detail of our life.
Yes.
He cares about how you feel. He cares that you're not able to wake up in the morning and have a song for him. He cares about that. He cares that you're broken. He cares that you're lonely. He cares that you're afraid. He cares that you think you're a reject. He cares that you think that you're not good enough. His blood wasn't shed in Calvary in vain. It was to give us life in abundance.
Yes.
Isaiah 41 says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God.
Amen.
I will strengthen you.
Yes,
I will help you. Yes, I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." You think God cares? Of course God cares. He gave his only begotten son. Do you think God cares? Of course God cares. James 1, 2-3. "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience." Isaiah 40, 28-29. "Have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary. He understands. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the weak. And to those who have no might, he increases strength." You see, the tables turned. Once Jesus entered into Jerusalem, what do you think the first thing he did was? Ran into the temple. This is a man who was focused on what he had to do. And when he saw the condition of the temple, when he saw the condition of the temple, when he saw what was happening, we need to have more reverence in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Yes, ma'am.
It's not a park. It's not a social place. There is a time and a place.
Yes, ma'am.
When God saw what was going on, when Jesus walked in and saw the temple, we know what he did.
Yes.
He tripped out. He flipped the tables over.
Yes.
What have they done to the house of the Lord? Yes. This house should be a house of prayer. We've turned it into like a marketplace here.
Yes.
And the shift started.
Yes.
How dare he correct us?
Mm-hmm.
What does he think he is?
Mm-hmm.
He knew he had to conquer death itself.
Yes.
Jesus saw God's house had been made a den of thieves.
Yes.
He turns over the tables. He frees the animals. And as he does that, the people turn on him. We no longer hear Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. The Son of Man gave it all. He was the perfect, spotless one. He lived a life of purity. He was a servant and he shed his blood on Calvary. He knew he had to conquer death itself. So, I'm almost done. Don't get nervous. Let's talk about the cult, the little cult. Jesus came in this little cult, which represented peace, restoration, and unity. Peace, restoration, and unity. You see, when a warrior came into town, they would come in a wonderful black or white stallion. Authority. Showing the significance that they're mighty and they're ready to battle. Mighty in battle. When the king entered on a donkey, it was a sign of peace.
Yes.
I come in peace.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't to be to feel threatened or to that there's war coming on. It was to say peace.
Mm-hmm.
Let's consider Jesus' statement walking into Jerusalem. What a historical event. Sometimes we think that our greatest necessity is a car, is status, maybe fame, maybe the beautiful wife or the beautiful husband. Our greatest necessity is not always what we think it is.
True.
Our greatest necessity should be to get right with God.
Amen.
Our greatest necessity, especially with what we're seeing with our political party, the state of our country, is to get right with God.
Yes.
To represent God
yes.
in our midst of trouble, in the storm.
Yes.
Get personal with God.
Yes.
Seek His face.
Yes.
Seek Him while He can still be found.
Hallelujah.
He is our King, our
yes.
precious Lord and
yes.
Savior.
Hallelujah.
Our most precious, greatest treasure. Isaiah 55:6 says, "Seek ye the Lord while He may be found. Call ye upon Him while He is near." We are all sinners cut from God. Our sin separates us from the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We need to be reconciled with God.
Thanks, my God.
That is why we run to church.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus said, "My house will be called a house of prayer, for all the nations."
Yes.
Matthew 21:13 says, "It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a robber's den." You see, the crowd that originally confessed Jesus and was saying, "Hosanna, Hosanna," were the same that 5 days later denied Him. It is very easy. I knew exactly what I was wearing today, my accessories. It was so easy putting my outfit together. It's very easy to get up and feel good about yourself
Amen.
When you make it to church on Sunday, because that's what you're supposed to do. It's really easy to do that. Come Monday, did we put Him on the cross too?
Mm-hmm.
Think about it. It's easy to get your praise on Sunday when you're connected to the brethren, when you have people encouraging you, when you have people embracing you and loving on you. It's great. It's easy. Right? We're doing the right thing coming in, as broken as we are.
Yes.
But are we like the people shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna,"
yes.
that on Friday we forgot about Jesus? Perhaps we denied Him. Perhaps my TV program was more important.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Perhaps I just didn't feel like obeying Him. Think about it. Think about it, how we conduct ourselves Monday through Saturday. Are we honoring our Lord, our Messiah, our King, our Deliverer, our Redeemer? Or are we taking advantage of His love and grace for us? Are we changing? Sisters, is there a change? Or are we still in the pattern? I've heard people say, and it's very sad, it broke my heart, actually. And I don't even remember how the conversation came up, but people are talking, maybe in passing, like, "Oh yeah, that's Daisy, oh, she's always like that, it's a pattern, she's up and down all the time, up and down, up and down. She's hot one day, bow, da da da." Horrible! Don't label each other.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, my sister's struggling again, let's go visit her. Let's
yes.
go pray for her.
Yes. Yes.
Let's go read the Word.
Yes.
Yes.
You know? We don't know what's in the depth of the heart.
True.
Don't give up on each other.
Yeah, that will.
The same way, 5 days later, they rejected the Lord, we ourselves start off good.
Yes.
We start off on Sunday really well. I want to thank my brothers and sisters because, you know what, Brother Rand, you're a blessing to my life. I'm just getting to know you. But when Brother Rand stands up here, when we were doing that 21-day fast, I even made fun of him a little bit, but in a good way. But I'm going to explain it. When he stood before us, you guys remember where he was like, "Well, I really don't like fasting, but I have to be obedient." You know, I chuckled a little bit, but I, you know what? To be transparent,
yes.
Here's a man of God that the Word flows. the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He is Lord of Lords, King of Kings, El Shaddai, Adonai.
Amen.
Gotta keep it real.
Yep.
I gotta keep it real. Pray for me, brothers and sisters.
Yes.
You know, I'm having a rough time with this. I gotta submit to the pastor. He said, I have to be obedient. But during that trial, during that process, he was getting. God was breaking and chipping and getting him ready for the next journey, for the next assignment. And I thought, Lord, thank you for leaders. Thank you for people, Father God, that seem like they arrived, but they're not afraid to say, I also suffer. Well, Sister Sharon gave her message as well. Thank you, Sister Sharon, for being transparent.
Yes.
Well, she's like, yeah! I got fleshly desires too! Yeah! I feel like sometimes being disobedient too! Yeah, sometimes the Lord has to smack me. I'm like, Sister Sharon? The Bible goes, hallelujah! That's Sister Sharon. She struggles, hallelujah! Thank you for being transparent, my Sister Sharon. Because you know what, with all kidding aside, this motivates the body of Christ.
Yes.
Because you know what happens for some people that don't know it's okay to mess up, dust yourself off, get up, and keep going, pressing forward. The enemy says you're nothing.
Hallelujah.
You're a loser.
Yes.
Don't even praise the Lord, you hypocrite. That's what the enemy does.
Yes.
So when we stand here and say, I messed up, please pray for me, I need help.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
That's what we say when we start confessing to one another.
Yes.
Pick up the line and say, I need help in this area.
Yes.
I just got high again. I'm not feeling good about this. I know I shouldn't have done this. I don't know why. But I'm really feeling paranoid right now. You know what? It helps the brethren to be transparent.
Yes.
You know? And the ones that say, I've arrived. Oh, don't say jokes.
Yeah.
I am so holy. Those could be the ones that have the dirtiest, filthiest heart before the presence of God. The Pharisees. They were threatened because here was the Son of God that knew the Word. He was the Word. He is the Word. And they were threatened by Him. They had their hidden agenda. Thank you for being transparent, church.
Yes.
You know, sometimes we're just too tired to pray.
Yes.
Sometimes we're too tired to serve.
Yes.
Sometimes we're too preoccupied with other things and too busy working overtime to pay for our bills.
Mm-hmm.
It's one thing to cheer. It's another thing to obey.
Yes.
Amen.
It's one thing to wear the sticker, to put the bumper sticker on the car. It's another thing to live the sticker on the card. John 14, 15. Once again, Brother Rand, were you looking at my notes?
No.
If you love me,
yes.
If you love me, you will keep my commands.
Amen.
You will keep my commandments. There has to be change.
Yes.
If we keep the commandments, there has to be change.
Yes.
We're no longer going to do these things.
Yes.
There has to be transformation.
Yes.
We need to be reformed through the blood of the Lamb. This blood was not shed in vain. There has to be change. If you love me, soul purpose, you will keep my commandments. In closing, I think I was okay with my timing. In closing, get ready to arise, church.
Yes.
If you must, dust yourself off.
Yes.
If you must, dust yourself off.
Mm-hmm.
If you must, repent.
Yes.
You don't need to have a bachelor's degree to preach.
Right. No.
You don't need 5 years of seminary school
No.
to share Christ.
No.
Yes.
You don't need someone to cheer you on.
Mm-hmm.
All you need to do is eat the scrolls, read your word, and obey the living God.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit will equip you to do what you need to do.
Amen.
Just as He sent two disciples to get the call, He will be precise.
Yes.
When you're called, God will give you all the resources that you need.
Yes.
In closing, church, 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 5. I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season.
Yes.
Can I say that again?
Yes.
Preach the word.
Hallelujah.
Be ready in and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. We're here. But according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap of themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. We need to know our word.
Yes.
Because there are a lot of people saying, I am a prophet.
True.
I am an evangelist.
That's right.
And they're distorting the word of God.
That's right.
They are sending people to the slaughter.
Yes.
There are many people saying it's okay. As long as you don't hurt nobody. I have different views now. It's okay if you want to be a homosexual. We need to know the word of God.
Amen.
Sole purpose, get ready.
Get ready.
Pick up the mantle and carry on the work of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Amen.
Just as Timothy picked up the mantle and carried on the work of Paul, and just as Joshua picked up the mantle and carried on the work of Moses, and just as Elijah picked up the mantle and carried on the work of Elijah, the church needs to arise.
Yes.
And pick up the mantle of the Son of Man.
Amen.
Pick up the mantle of the Son of Man.
Hallelujah.
Our Lordship, our King, Jesus Christ. Let us not waste any more time, for the harvest is plenty.
Yes.
For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom. God bless you.